Once upon a time, there was a little boy called Abe.
That was you.
That was me. And he lived in a lovely children's home on a little island near Wales, where the sun shone every day. The headmistress, Miss Peregrine, was very clever.
When I was a kid, my grandmother would drag me to these flea markets and swap meets, and I started to find old pictures, black and white pictures. I found a picture of a little girl, very old, and there was something that haunted me deeply about the idea that this little girl, that she had been dead, and convinced me that old pictures had this life beyond themselves that was really fascinating. So that was kind of a bug in my head that stayed with me for a long time. Years later, I was living in Los Angeles, and I found at a swap meet in Pasadena a guy who was selling old photos. I bought a whole bunch of them and I got really obsessed with them. I had an idea for a story, and then they were part of the genesis of the idea for Miss Peregrine.
Roll, please. And action.
Or sit up or something.
When I heard that Tim Burton was going to make the film, I was like, what? This is insane. It was so exciting to me that he was interested in the book and was taking this on as a project.
Oh my God. It was really, really great.
Absolutely. Yeah, I can't wait to see your vision come to life.
Well, it's a great book.
Really. So much.
What a great cast and everything.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Really, I just like Ranson's book. I like the fact that he made a story out of, you know, finding these old photographs and things, which I love. I collect photographs and things, and I love the fact that you can see an image and it tells you a story without telling you everything. So that he concocted a story based on this kind of strange, unknown photographs, I just found very compelling, very strong, very dreamlike, very powerful, and again, mysterious was just something that I think the book had.
What isn't in this book that's like a Tim Burton movie?
The elements, the tone, the world, the interesting and off-center characters.
It lends itself to cinematic material the second you look at it. You're just, you know, it's so visually arresting.
I sort of married together my obsession with vintage photos and images and stories and words and mashed them all up.
We're what's known in common parlance as peculiar.
So our characters, they're peculiars. I think it really ties in with Tim's sensibilities. If you look at some of the characters that he's created in his career, even with some of his illustrated books, they're kind of like, not flawed superheroes, but they're abilities that if people didn't really know how to use them, they would kind of be anchored down by them in a way. So I think in a way it goes with his sensibilities where these are a bit off center. These aren't your normal children. They just are afflicted with these peculiarities.
Claire, why aren't you eating?
She's embarrassed in front of Jake.
Don't be, please.
It's like those feelings of people who are branded peculiar or different. You know, I was just branded strange because I like monster movies, so what's so strange about that? You go through that in your childhood, you go through that in your life, and so I think there's a lot of people that feel peculiar out there. And I think that's, again, something that struck with me. It's a very basic feeling different when you feel that way. That's what the book is. I mean, that's what Ransom sort of built everything upon that. So whether you see the photographs or not see them, it's an important part of the vibe of it.
I think from the moment I read the book, I could picture it as a movie, and most particularly as a movie directed by Tim. The visuals are a massively strong part of the book, and so, you know, it's not a huge leap to see it in a cinematic sense.
When I heard she was writing the adaptation, I was super excited. And then, you know, a year later, I got a script. And, you know, I saw these things that Jane had written and Tim had done, and I thought, like, I wish I'd done that. I wish I'd thought of that. That's so smart.
The book hadn't been out that much, so I wasn't even aware of what people liked about it. Usually when your book has been around, you know, you gotta have that sequence, or you gotta have this or that. This didn't feel that way to me. This felt more of an emotional sort of feeling than it is like this and that happening. So we just try to be true to the spirit of it.
I think some of the challenges were actually about extending the end of the story, which is actually unusual for an adaptation. Quite often you're you know, having to cut things out. But actually, you know, the story was so sort of beautifully and succinctly told that it almost, it felt that it could continue.
Go to her, Jake. You have the map. You can get back to 1943.
Honestly, I think it's more interesting than seeing page for page exactly what happens in the book. For cinematic reasons that pay off really well, their powers have been switched around and changed a little bit. So now Emma, rather than summoning fire from her fingertips, controls air and is lighter than air.
The changes from the book to Emma came out of conversations that Tim and I both had, and I think we both felt the same way, that it was almost the dynamic in the relationship and the fire ability just felt a little similar to maybe things that we'd seen before.
And action!
The floating was such a beautiful visual, that the peculiarity of being lighter than air, it felt there was so much you could do, you know, in terms of Jake's interactions with Emma and his relationship with her.
I nearly messed that up.
Abe did too, the first time.
It's a great peculiarity, but there's so much stuff you can do.
It allows her to raise the ship and have this amazing scene, and all of this cool stuff that happens was enabled by her having that ability.
Of course, there's the element of fantasy that you always have in a Tim Burton film. So that gives you license to stray away from the historical facts and the historical looks and be a bit more creative with the whole visual thing of the film. Tim is very much a director who will let you have your own creative input. So, for example, if a script asks for a particular thing for a character, I will tend to do about 10 versions of what I think it should be, and then I will show those ideas to Tim and to Colleen Costume, and together we'll choose which one we think will work best.
The process of film design and filmmaking is a collaborative process. You're creating a character to help move a story forward. And so in the beginning you talk to the director about his vision of what the script is and what the character is. So you kind of have a better direction of where to go with it. And then I meet with the actor and talk about how they see the character, show them my ideas, and then start making from that point.
She shows up and her design concept is, it's pretty much perfect and spot on.
The monsters, Jake. He'll slaughter anything in the path.
To be in this costume, it kind of makes it easy as an actor. It helps you to get under the skin of the character.
For sure, it's a collaboration. There's a lot of inspiration in what Colleen produces that helps me a lot. And I really value her opinion in what I do with the hair and makeup as well.
I just think the feeling of the book and the mood of the book and the sort of images in the book evoke a certain sort of style, and each character is sort of almost an exaggeration. So each one is kind of the sort of iconic version of that in a way that sort of made it a fun challenge.
I really enjoyed the creative process. And again, I try to work with people that I really love.
It's always amazing working with Tim. He looks at the big picture.
The shots and the colors and the angles, I mean, it's very inspiring to write some music for that stuff.
I think simple is a repeating thing that Tim talked about. He wanted it to feel something that you could really latch onto. He always talked about the music not wanting to feel too busy, also not too big, and he kept using the word poetic. If we'd recorded an orchestral cue, it's like, let's dial that back and let's look at what else is in there, you know, favoring some synth stuff and some real, you know, certainly non-organic stuff. He was not scared to try that, which was great for us.
We thought, what did Ransom Riggs have in mind when he wrote the story? And Tim really wanted this film to be peculiar. It is a good word. It describes a lot of what's happening on this movie.
It's weird to think that we're in some way collaborators, even though I did my collaboration years ago and now he's doing his part. But still sort of the marriage of these two, you know, pieces of the puzzle. And I wanted to visit the set because who wouldn't? I love movies and movie making, and to see not only the film being made from my book, but Tim Burton making the film of my book and on this grand scale was something I just had to see.
We're in Belgium, in a little town called Brechat, on the outskirts of Antwerp. And this is the Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children movie set. It says verboten, but we can go in here. It's not verboten to us. It's like something out of a storybook. And I don't mean that as a pun or anything. It's like classic fairy tale type house. There's a bird, which is thematically appropriate. It's fantastic. This is the exciting part, which is when you get to watch Tim Burton direct the movie, where I still am like pinching myself because I can't believe it's happening.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take this home with me. I think the rule is that the author gets one prop from the set as a memento, and I choose this. This is one of the carrots in the wild. Now these are real, I believe real tomatoes, which, no, they're not real tomatoes. I even got faked out. This is the best movie. And that's it, they're very healthy kids. They just eat these vegetables, and that's how they live to be so old. So eat your vegetables, kids, and you can live to be 100 years old and still look like you're a teenager too.
It's been like the treat of my life to be here and to walk into these sets of Miss Peregrine's house and the kids, and to walk onto Cairnholm Island and the village, which were so similar to what I had imagined, that I thought, like, you know, maybe Tim had spied on my dreams or something.
How did you...
It's my peculiarity.
Really fits, and you can see it in the art direction, the cinematography, the sets, everything really comes together as a Tim Burton film.
For fans of Ransom and Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, it's a full rendering. It's Tim Burton. It's the collaboration of Tim Burton and Ransom bringing this story to life, and it's a full world. It's a zany world. It's a wild world.
It's creepy and sweet. It's scary and funny. Ultimately, there's a heart of gold inside the slightly unusual, uncanny exterior. Everyone has totally invested themselves into these million details that make up the tapestry of the movie, and it's so cool to see how all of their work gels together to create Miss Peregrine.
Don't just stand there, come in. Your tea's getting cold.